Morning, everybody. Good to see you here. Ethan, how are we doing with the live stream? Everything all right? All right. Good morning, live stream. Thanks for being here with us. So we may have a few more folks coming in here over the next couple of minutes, but we're going to go ahead and get started. So for the folks who are here, you've been bringing in your Christmas child boxes. That's exciting. Thank you very much for bringing those in and doing the work with all of those over the last week. So I do have a couple of announcements this morning, and then we will get started with the service. So still, Christmas Child is going to be continuing on here for the next little bit. So next week we'll have some things going on with that as well. So as part of that, this doesn't necessarily affect this group so much, but I do want to just say it for the sake of putting it out there, spoken as well as through email, Facebook, and so forth. But Saturday the 21st, we will not have a service here in the building. So Sunday, yes. Right? Everybody got that? Sunday, we are here, okay? But Saturday the 21st, we are not going to have that service. All right, for those who are here, when you were coming in, you may have seen the very large tub that we have of collecting the socks. So we only have a little bit of more time to do that. The 23rd is going to be the final date for that. So if you were wanting to try and be part of that, that would be great. It is partnering with a group of students at Plymouth State. There's some classes that they have to do where they do a project called Tackling a Wicked Problem. And so we are partnering with them as they are with one of those projects. And so the socks are going to be going to down to Concord, to a group in Concord. So children's socks. Live stream, this goes for you as well. If you're in the area, you want to be part of this, just arrange with me to drop them off during the week sometime, and we will gladly take them. So thank you very much for those who have already brought socks in. That's really encouraging. All right, Bridge House. So talk with Melissa about, for those of you who are here, about donating the food. You're going to be here Wednesday and Thursday, you think, or just Thursday morning to grab the food? Okay. All right. Live stream, if you're wanting to be part of this, it would really help to get an email of the item and what day would work for you to drop the food off, either Wednesday or Thursday of the Thanksgiving week there. So please contact me. Side items, especially sweet potato casserole, is that right? there's a very big desire for that. All right, no shock to anybody, I don't think, who has been paying attention, we were talking about this yesterday at the service as well, and Jeremy was here. Jeremy reminded us that stupid COVID is getting stupider. So we are dealing with it here in our area pretty heavily right now. So we want to be very careful in this space because we want to be able to keep gathering as long and as much as possible. So we all need to mentally prepare ourselves for the possibility of having to go remote again. That could happen at any moment, really. I hope to avoid it as much as I can, but we have to just be ready for that possibility. So the thing that will help us is that if you are ever feeling any symptoms of just about nearly anything, just go ahead and stay home and join us by the live stream. And if you are able to be here, then being really cautious with the masking, and we have hand sanitizer, using that because we just want to take care of each other. Live stream, you can be praying for us, for those who are able to gather here, that we'll be able to do it safely and stay out of the news. That is one of my top goals here. I do not want to make the news. So if we do, we'll try to use it as a way to glorify God. But I really would like to avoid it as much as I can. All right, we're here to worship, right? So let's do that. Let me pray for us as our call of worship, and then we'll get started with the services. I'm praying the worship team can begin making their way. Heavenly Father, thank you for today and just another opportunity to gather here in person and through technology with the live stream. Father, you are good and you're gracious to us. We pray for protection and help as we just continue to live with the reality of these challenges. It's nothing new. It's nothing surprising to you. But it's a good reminder of how much we are in need of you. So, Father, be here with us and go before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand, put on our masks, and prepare to sing.
Good morning, Gateway family. It is, as ever, an honor and a privilege to be worshiping with you this morning. Things that have been on my heart, especially recently the last couple of weeks, is how are we reaching out to each other? Just especially in this time, more than ever, people are so isolated, especially as COVID, you know, numbers are spiking, which can seem scary to a lot of people. I know a lot of people in my own life who have now started to really pull back. So let's just make sure that we are reaching out to one another and just being the hands and feet of Jesus. So let's go before the Lord together. It's a wonderful space to be in here. Holy Spirit, we just invite you into this place. Lord, teach us how to worship you. Bring us closer together.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger.
My brothers and sisters, my prayer for you from this next song is that we would reflect on how God is our rock. And not only how God is our rock, but how Jesus is the cornerstone of our lives. In this time of uncertainty and of chaos, guys, let us just fix our eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on Jesus. He is the calm in the storm, and he will bring peace to all that is happening in this world right now. Remember, our God is with us. You all may be seated.
All right, thank you to the music team, and thank you for joining in and worshiping with us today. It's always great to hear your voices and live stream folks. I hope, I wish I could hear your voices as well. So our scripture reading is in Psalm 16 for today. Psalm 16. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel, and the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Let's pray. And as I pray for us, this is a time for you to pray as well and to be reminded of our good and gracious God. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and Lord, I thank you for this psalm, and I thank you for the truth in it. Help us to believe it. Help us to see the beauty in it and to find our hope in you. I'm glad that you know about this earth, about this life. I'm glad that you have communicated with us. I'm glad that you have not left us alone. Father, help us to see you, desire you, to be willing to give our lives to you. Lord, you are greater, better, you are more beautiful. Your grace and your mercy, your justice, nothing can compare. So we rightly praise you. As we spend some time in your word this morning in James and in Luke, Father, guide us, open our minds and our hearts to your word. May you speak this morning. May this be your message and not mine. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There was no special today, right? I forgot to ask, and that would have been bad. So, all right. Today we begin looking at the final chapter of the letter of James. And so if you have your Bible, or if you have an app or whatever, you can start finding James chapter 5. We're also going to go into the Gospel of Luke for a little bit as well this morning. So if you want to find that one early, or just be aware of that, that would be great. We've spent several weeks with this letter of James now. And when reading this letter, I think we get a sense, a small sense, we can't know entirely, but I think we get a sense of who James was. And when you read this letter, you get the sense that James was really serious about what he was saying, right? I think he took this very seriously. He believed firmly what he wrote by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and he was not doubtful as he wrote this. I firmly believe that. I also get the sense that he was probably really intense, right? He may have had a great sense of humor. I don't know that. But I think we can at least tell that he was an intense individual. But to me, at least, I think it makes sense when we think through some other aspects about this. When we read through Scripture, especially with the New Testament and the disciples in the New Testament, we see this incredible change that takes place. We see, with certain individuals, we see a movement from ambivalence or unknowing or hatred or selfish motives to this resolute, passionate determination about God and His ways. You can just watch this amazing development, this amazing maturity with some of the disciples and some of the followers of Christ, of just how they changed. And when you read some of these accounts and stories and so forth, you can see that they were absolutely dedicated. They believed fully, firmly in what they were saying and in who they were following. And I think this is important because while I've been saying we can get a pretty good sense of what James is writing here without having to do a whole bunch of, you know, Greek, Hebrew, anything like that. We can get a sense of what he's writing. But how do we interpret it? How do we interpret what is being said here? And then how do we live it? How do we interpret? How do we live? Because that's the pattern. We read it, we interpret it, and then we live it. Read, interpret, and then live. A couple sentences from my reading this week. When we see Christ as Lord objectively, that is, exalted to the throne of heaven, then we shall experience the power of the Holy Spirit upon us. When we see Christ as Lord subjectively, that is, effective ruler within our lives, then we shall know the power of the Holy Spirit within us. So, are we seeing objectively? Yes, Jesus is on the throne. God is on the throne. And He has say over my life. That's going to move us to the Holy Spirit. And as Christians, we've been told that we're not alone in this world. And that is really good news. That is incredibly good news for us, that we're not alone, right? God doesn't expect us to do all of this ourselves or to even figure it all out just ourselves, right? We have God the Holy Spirit to help us, to guide us, to show us how to read, how to interpret, how to live, right? It's not just from our own thinking. So we read it, Scripture, we read Scripture, and we pray, God, help me to understand. Right? Help me to understand. We interpret it and we pray. God, help me to interpret correctly. Right? Am I interpreting this correctly? We live it and we pray. God, help me to live it. Right? We read, we pray. We interpret, we pray. We live, we pray. I mentioned this briefly because I think there's this sense that we can look out over the landscape of Christianity. How do we be Christians? What does it mean for us to be Christians in this life? And in all honesty, it should be overwhelming. Like, I'm supposed to do that? I'm supposed to live this way? Right? There's this sense of where it should, I think, absolutely be overwhelming. If we move to this place of, oh, become a Christian, it's really easy. We're making a sales pitch. We're not telling the truth. Okay? It should overwhelm us because that drives us to say, I need more of God in my life constantly, every day, every moment, because I can't do this myself. I can't live this myself. I can't live the way that God wants me to live to bring Him glory from who I am. I need God the Holy Spirit to do this for me and in me and with me, right? As this clarity and desire deepens and develops, we should see maturity and excitement and love. And I think it can help us get a sense of why James phrases things the way he does. And our section today will show us again of James. James could be blunt. Right? I don't have time for this. Here it is. Right? Just a very blunt statement. And then it's almost like, here it is. You're going to get hit with it. Now what are you going to do with it? Right? I mean, this is kind of how James operates in this letter. But I think it would be a mistake to conclude from that James is being heartless or uncaring. Right? I don't think that he's being heartless or uncaring in his blunt message here in his letter. Just imagine with me, you may have experienced this or you may have seen this in some sense of someone who becomes very serious about applying very strong sunblock whenever they're in the sun because they have experienced skin cancer, right? Someone who has gone through that of being diagnosed, going through operations, all that kind of stuff, they're going to say, I'm going to cover my skin. I'm going to put sunblock, and they're going to tell everyone they know, hey, put sunblock on. And they're going to take it very seriously, right? Not because they're uncaring or heartless, but because they're actually more caring. Because they don't want anybody else to go through what they have gone through themselves. You see? This just blunt honesty from James, I think, is coming from like, hey, don't miss this. Because if you miss this, it's going to be worse if I was just really kind of wishy-washy on this. I'm being blunt because of how serious it is, because I know of what it's like to have a different mindset. I know what it's like to think differently about God and Jesus. I think we're reading this letter from the transformed life and mind of James. He's been transformed by Christ, and we see that as he writes through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He is single-minded toward Christ. There's a people group in Kenya who prepare walking sticks by cutting a stick from a bush, and then they place a section over it, over a fire for a period of time, and then they remove it, and they shave that section, and they just rotate the stick, put it over the fire for a period of time, and then save that section. And they've built and made this wisdom parable from this process that they go through in making these walking sticks. And here's the wisdom parable that they have from that. They say, you cannot work on two walking sticks over the fire at the same time. One will burn. You can't work on two sticks at the same time because you're going to focus in on one and the other one is going to be destroyed by the fire. Single-mindedness. That's what James is getting at here, and I think that's what the entirety of Scripture is getting at. It's a good reminder for us, that wisdom parable, in this aspect, because it's one of the central themes throughout this letter, right? We cannot be double-minded in our relationship with God. And as I've mentioned, what James is getting at from that is that we cannot have two souls. Don't be double-souled, he's saying. Don't be double-minded is how we've kind of translated it out. But it's, in a sense, saying you can't have two souls. Well, this soul will be with God on Sunday morning, and then my other soul is just for me Monday through Saturday. Right? James would say, you haven't quite figured it out yet. Right? Much more eloquently, of course. We have to be single-minded. This week, just came across this just kind of brief story. I don't have all the details or anything, but as far as I know, it is a true story. But there was a surgeon who was conducting a surgery on a young girl, and they needed to give her some blood as part of the surgery, and they did not have her exact blood match at the hospital to be able to do it. So they went to the family, and her brother had the matching blood. And so the surgeon went to the brother and said, we need your blood for your sister. Will you be willing to give your blood for her? And the brother just sat very quietly and just thought for a moment. And then he stood up And he hugged his parents and he said, "Goodbye." And he walked with the surgeon and they laid him down on the table and they hooked him up and they took his blood. And after they took his blood, he looked up at the surgeon and he said, "When will I die?" He thought, "I am going to die from this to save my sister." So when he said goodbye to his parents, he wasn't thinking, "I'll see you in a little bit. We'll go get ice cream." He thought, "This is it." He was single-minded to save his sister to the point of losing his life. I think that captures what James is getting at. Do not be double-minded towards God, because he isn't double-minded towards us. James gives warnings toward this throughout his letter, and we're going to cover two sections today. And the first one is a warning. Now, there's a long history of us humans twisting scripture to fit our political, sociological, and cultural desires. And I implore us to fight against that with everything that we have, okay? And if we're going to hear this section in just one moment, and you'll probably see what I'm getting at. But we have a long history of doing this, of where we will read a portion of Scripture and we'll say, "Aha! I know what to do with this." And it has absolutely nothing to do with God and what he is saying. All right? So this is a warning inside of a warning, okay? We have to be very, very careful about taking Scripture and twisting it and forming it to whatever it is that we desire or what we think is the best way of how to live on this earth. Because most of the time, it's going to have nothing to do with God and the fullness of his word and the fullness of who he is. All right, so we have to be very careful about this. If you're unfamiliar, I say this and I take this very seriously, I'm not going to give any details about it. If you want to know more, I can tell you more later on. But I read a book a few years ago, and at the end of the book, it was a biography about this individual, and they shared some of this person's like writings and deeper thoughts about some stuff. And there was a section of where he was talking about a portion of Scripture, and he was saying, "Here's this portion of Scripture, and this is what it means," and he took that, twisted it to his meaning, and moved out to do just absolute barbaric cruelty. And he would say, "Scripture tells me that I can do this." And it was absolutely nothing to do with who God is and what God wants. Absolutely not. Perfectly clear that it was a complete and total twisting of God's word. We don't always realize it. This is why, again, Holy Spirit and prayer. But if we twist God's word to fit our purposes, it will not work out. This is not ours to do what we want with it. This is the revelation of God. This is God's word. Father God, what do you want us to know about you from your word? Not, "Oh, here's this, I can use it in this way." All right? James 5. I'm going to read this long section, and then we'll come back to a couple pieces later on. James 5, verse 1. "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in the day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remained steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brothers, do not swear, either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. All right, now when we read this, I think what we see is that James is an echo of Christ. His message is consistent with the teaching of Christ on these matters. And that needs to be our hope and desire for our lives as well, that we are an echo of Christ, that we share Christ's message on these matters. Well, how does that happen? We have to know what Christ said. We have to know what he taught, right? And it is painfully clear. James knew Scripture really well. James knew the teaching of Jesus really, really well, right? I don't think the Holy Spirit was holding his hand and just writing this out. I think there is an aspect of just his own mind through this as well. You can see he's interacting with all of this, what we call the Old Testament. And he's interacting with a lot of Jesus' teachings and so forth. It's just all through this letter, right? And so that's encouraging and really important that he is being consistent with the message of Jesus. Now, this first verse, and I told you, James can be blunt, right? And we see it here, right? You rich weep and howl, right, for the miseries that are coming upon you. Now, if we're not careful, this can be an example of the trickiness of interpretation that I have been talking about, right? And depending on our starting point of interpretation, we can end up in very different places from this, right? If you're anything like me, you're not rich, right? We are not rich. Here's the thing. 99.9999, and just going down the line with nine, of people will say, I'm not rich. Because there's always somebody with a little bit more. Right? We have the list of wealthiest people, all that kind of stuff. Talk to a bunch of people on that list. They're going, I'm not wealthy because look at that guy, right? Or look at that lady, right? Okay? So this is why it's not about starting from what we desire and what we want and so forth, because it can be really easy. And in this day and age, right now, we're dealing with this, where we can look at a group of people and we can say, yeah, bad. How dare you? And all kinds of other things. And then we'll come and we'll read scriptures. Oh, see, God thinks the same thing about you. I don't think that's what's going on here. I think we got to be very careful about this. If our starting point is from God, then we will see that the miseries upon the rich that is being talked about here are talking about final judgment. It's talking about final judgment. If our starting point is from ourselves, then we could, and I'm not saying this would be the only situation, but we could end up twisting this verse toward a message about karma. We use this word, we swim in this mentality of karma, right? Very, very simplistic kind of understanding of based upon your actions and character, you're either rewarded or punished. Does that seem fair? Right? Well, if I do good things, then I'm going to get good things. Right? If I'm bad, then bad things will happen, folks. Karma is an entirely unbiblical mentality. It doesn't exist. But it's very easy to read through some of the portions of Scripture and to get that thought process. But from my humble opinion, karma is not in Scripture. All right? It's not there. We could never earn the goodness and grace that God has shown us. We can never earn that. Right? We can never earn it. And we are so much worse than we would ever imagine. Each one of us. Tim Keller, Pastor Tim Keller, is really strong on this point. If you engage with some of his writing or teaching, you will end up seeing this quite clearly. Of where we can get pretty high and mighty on ourselves, right? And we can look at a group of people and approach this from this kind of from ourselves perspective, and move it to a place that is not the intention of Scripture, not the intention of this portion of Scripture. If we are willing to be honest, we will all individually say, I'm not a very nice person. I'm not that great. I am a sinner who sins. And this is why I need Jesus. Do you see why we need the Holy Spirit? To help us to engage with God's word, to engage with how do we live this life in a godly way? One of the most influential theologians in my life said this to me the other day about our culture. They said, our materialism has become our entertainment. Our materialism has become our entertainment. If you don't agree with that statement, I happen to agree with it, but if you don't agree with it, you can take it up with Chrissy, my wife, because she's the one who said it. And as I say, she's one of the most influential theologians in my life. Right? I think she's right. I think that's true. And this can cloud our judgment. This can cloud our desires. Right? God will, in fact, at times provide financial help for us. I have plenty of stories of that in my own life. But God's ultimate answer will not be money. God's ultimate answer is not going to be money. I was driving around this week. In fact, I had just a little bit of the time. I had gotten most of the stuff done, so I just went out to just kind of clear my head and try to get some photographs and stuff. And as I was driving, just thinking, you know, there's a lot of things I want, right? And I'm pretty sure I need all of them, right? And I just started thinking about all of this stuff that is like, it would be really nice if I could just have this right now, right? And I drove, I was up at Stinson Lake. I was driving by, and there was a for sale sign for a piece of property. And it just got me curious. I don't know if anybody else does this or not, but you see a for sale sign, you're just curious about the house, right? So I got home, and I got the itchy fingers. Right? So I got online, and I found it. I found the house. Now, just a little bit ago, I've been saying, it'd be great. You know, to own property and to have, I want some of this stuff. Right? And this property, this house, $2.6 million. Right? And it is gorgeous. Oh, it is fantastic. Right? It's beautiful. Oh, I had to fight. Right? You ever get like this? You gotta fight it. You gotta fight it because. Right, and here's what you got to do. You got to start thinking about like other things, right? Because this $2.6 million is huge, right? You say, oh, that's a lot of cleaning, right? This is what you got to balance it out, right? Oh man, and it's the location is like, ooh, that could be really loud at times with the other people, I'd be really frustrated about it. I don't want that, right? You gotta fight hard about your wants and sometimes, right? If we get stuck in this pattern, it's like, wait a minute, God, I'm not getting what I want. And it looks like everybody else is. Have you ever gone to that place? Everything is working out perfectly for everyone else, except for this guy. Right? Okay. God's ultimate answer is not going to be, oh, I want you happy, so here's that thing you wanted. We are not rich or poor according to what we have, but according to who we are. I don't even remember who said that, but it's not me, but I agree with it. We're not rich or poor according to what we have, but according to who we are. When we introduce ourselves to someone, we state our name, not our financial status. We may give some hints to it by how we're dressed and so forth. But we state our name. We lead with our name. I am Dennis Simmons. That is who I am. And God is not so much concerned with, well, let me give you this. I've given you something. My son, Jesus. I want you to want more of him. I want more of me. Jesus tells two parables that are very important as part of this discussion, I think. The first is in Luke 15. I'm going to summarize this parable for us. A lot of us will be familiar with it. But in Luke 15, we have the parable of the prodigal son, right? It's a fairly well-known story for those of us who have been in the church for any amount of time. Let me summarize the story, but it's in Luke 15. If you can read it later on, that would be fantastic. But there was a father who had two sons, and the younger son one day came to his father and said, hey, Dad, I'm kind of sick of you. I'm kind of sick of being here. Give me the inheritance, my share of the inheritance, because I want it, and I'm gonna get out of here, right? And so the father amazingly says, okay, fine, here is your share of the inheritance. And the younger son does in fact leave. And he goes and he parties and he lives it up and he's just, you know, living a life that's apart from the father and just based around spending this inheritance. And all of a sudden, you know, spoiler alert, all the money's gone. Right? All the stuff is gone. All the friends are gone. He's desperate. He's alone. And he finds himself feeding and tending pigs. And he is so desperate. And he has absolutely nothing. He begins looking at the food the pigs are eating and saying, oh, that looks pretty good. Right? And he comes to this place. He comes to this decision of, I'm going to return back to the Father. I'm going to go back to Father, because that is where I should be. I never should have left, but I can't go back as a son. I'll go back as a slave. So he begins to return back home. As he's a little ways off, his father sees him and he runs. This is a scandalous part of the story. He runs to his son and he embraces him. And the son begins in on his apology and begins to say, you know, I know that I can't come back as a son, so I'll be a slave, but just please let me be here in your presence again. And the father says, silly child, you're my son. You're my child. Here's my robe. Here's my ring. Here's shoes for your feet. And we're going to kill the fattened calf because you've come home, you're alive, we're throwing a party. Right? We're going to have a party. We're going to kill the fattened calf. It's going to be fantastic. My son is home. My son is alive. And Jesus continues the story. They go, they kill the fattened calf. The party begins, and the older brother, the older son, comes, and he sees what's going on, and he's not full of happiness. He says, Father never did this for me. Father never killed the fattened calf for me. What is going on? This isn't fair. Right? Now, Jesus was telling this story for a specific reason. What I want us to do for our purposes today is to imagine a couple more scenes with this story. Now, this is my own rendition, all right? So this isn't in Luke 15, all right? So if it goes off the rails, it's my fault, not God's, okay? But just imagine a couple more scenes with me. The older son is there. He's had a confrontation with his father, and he's outside, and he's just sulking, right? He's got the pouty lip going, right? He's upset. He's angry. And his brother comes out looking for him. And they have this interaction. He says, "What's going on, brother? Aren't you going to come in and eat? The food's ready. Father is in there. Come on. Come on. We're going to eat. This is going to be fantastic." And the older brother says, "No, I'm upset. Father never gave me a party like this. I don't have his robe or his ring. I don't have new shoes. I've never been given a party like this. They've never killed a fattened calf for me. I don't have any of this stuff. I'm not going in there. I'm angry. You left. You took Father's stuff, what that didn't belong to you. You took it before he was even dead. That's not how this inheritance thing's supposed to work. And you knew that. You didn't care. You took it. You left. You went to that other country. You squandered it. It's gone. It's lost. Now you want to come back and join the family again. How dare you? Who do you think you are? I'm not going in there to party with you. I've stayed here. I've worked. I've been with Father. This should be my party, not yours. How dare you? No. Stay away from me." And the younger brother looks at his older brother and he says, Brother, look. I've made a lot of mistakes. And I'm sorry. But I've matured a lot. Since I left, that day that I left, and you remember those things that I said and so forth? Yeah, look, it was a mistake, and I'm sorry, but I am different now, and I have matured. And here's the thing that I have learned, brother. Here's the thing that I have learned. This robe and this ring and these shoes and that really good food in there, they're great. They're nothing compared to Father. This is what I've learned. I gave all of myself to all of this stuff before, but I missed it. And now that I've left and I've come back and I've matured and I've seen the difference, brother, trust me, this stuff is nothing compared to Father. I came back not for the robe or the ring or the shoes or the food. I came back to be with Father. Brother, Father's in there waiting for us. Let's go. Come on, let's go and eat. Let's go and eat and be with Father, because Father is the real treasure in this place, not this stuff. Not this stuff. Again, Jesus didn't say all of that. But I hope that's a faithful rendering of just a couple of more scenes of conversation between the brothers. Right? The second story is in Luke 16. And I'm going to read this one for us quickly. We're not going to dive into it, but just listen close or follow along. Luke chapter 16, beginning in verse 19. "There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. Besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. And he said, Then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. And he said to them, If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. All right. Now, again, spend some time with this story if you can, because we're not digging into the fullness of it today. But do you see, if we approach this from a wrong starting point, we could say, we could make this conclusion just from this one section of, you see, if you're rich in this earth, then you're going to go to hell. So it's better to not have anything, to be miserable and to be like Lazarus and just have nothing, because that's how you're going to get to heaven. That's not what Scripture is saying. And it's not the point of what Jesus is getting at here. You see, so we have to be careful, again, about how we think through these things. Our starting point is our starting point from just simply betterment of my life and so forth. If that's the case, we're gonna twist things. We're gonna move things. You see, there's some different things in here that we could make some really dangerous conclusions from. So we have to be very, very careful about that, right? What I want us to notice from this story in this is the mindset of the rich man in the story. So while they were on earth, he had complete disregard for Lazarus. He was just taking in everything that he wanted, and he didn't even bother to help Lazarus at all, right? But notice in the story of this incredible thing, he still has disregard for Lazarus. Hey, send Lazarus to me. See, that is such a dangerous, dangerous concept, right? It's such a dangerous mindset. And then that ending section, is the concern for the brothers only about escaping torment? Or is it about the glory of God? Jesus makes this incredible statement of, well, they have Scripture. They can read Scripture. And he's saying, well, no, that's not going to be good enough. What they need to see is this, like, this miraculous thing of this guy coming back from the dead. And Jesus just calls it out. And he says, no. You see, they'll disregard it. They won't listen to it. It will not motivate them or move them in any way whatsoever. Because they're at the wrong starting point, much like you. Right? When our desires for not God dominate our lives, we won't be convinced even by something miraculous. Now, we can sit here and say, and I have some great stories of my failures in saying in one setting, oh, if such and such happens, I will definitely do this. Right? And then such and such happened, and I didn't do what I said I would do. Right? And it's a very humbling experience. If you've not experienced that, I hope at some point you will. Right? It's humbling. It's shattering of, oh, I thought I was going to be so brave. Oh, I really thought I would be a very noble person if this happened. I thought I was above thinking that I should have a $2.6 million house. Quickly, I'm taking your time today, quickly. Back in James 5. James 5, verse 7. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it, till it receives the early and the late rains. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remain steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. If we put this in list form, I think it helps to kind of solidify it in our minds. So what is James saying here? He says, be patient, establish your hearts, do not grumble. Does James know about 2020? Do not grumble. Right? This is why we have to be careful, right? Because James 5, verse 1, come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming. Yeah, get them, right? And then James comes along and says, hey, don't even grumble. Right? And it's like, oh, yeah. You got me, James. Good one. All right. Yeah. Be patient. Establish your hearts. Do not grumble. Know the stories of our predecessors. Be steadfast and be very careful about our words. That's the list. Lord help us, right? This list should overwhelm us. It should overwhelm us because that will drive us to prayer. And here's the prayer. Help us, Holy Spirit. Help us, right? We're not going to work this up from ourselves. We have to receive it. We have to receive it. From my reading, Satan wants us to get impatient with God, for an impatient Christian is a powerful weapon in the devil's hands. Moses' impatience robbed him of a trip to the Holy Land. Abraham's impatience led to the birth of Ishmael, the enemy of the Jews. And Peter's impatience almost made him a murderer. When Satan attacks us, it is easy for us to get impatient and run ahead of God and lose God's blessing as a result. The one example there that this author mentioning that just sets my brain with so many thoughts is Peter almost became a murderer. Of course, he's talking about in the Garden of Gethsemane when Peter thought, oh, I'm really going to take care of these folks. And he pulls out his sword and he swipes and all he gets is an ear. That was the grace of God. Because imagine if he had killed that servant. Imagine the difference. Imagine the difference, right? Because Jesus had said, Peter, you're going to be instrumental in the building of the church, right? We would not have those amazing sermons in the book of Acts from Peter. We wouldn't have them. Because he got ahead of God, and he tried to take it into his own hands, and he tried to kill someone. Praise God that he is patient with us, right? When we read through the Gospels, we can see how patient Jesus was. He was so patient with his disciples, and he's so patient with us. A really good teacher is going to be patient with their pupils, knowing that it's a process, and it doesn't all click at once. Jesus is the greatest teacher, right? So pray for patience, but know that it is only developed by being worked into you, right? You will be known as being a patient person by being placed in situations where patience will exude, right? If it's never shown, then no one will know that you are patient. The descriptor will come from the action, right? We got to be ready for that. It's worthwhile. We are to be truthful to our word and not swear by oaths because ultimately it will reflect back onto God. I swear can sometimes betray a history of lying or being untrustworthy. Right, I swear. Right? It's showing that you haven't always been truthful here. Or it could assume possession over something that we don't actually possess. By the moon, by the stars, by God. Oh, no. Absolutely not. Right? Now, I'm almost finished. Hang in there with me. I really like to tell stories. Right? I love to tell stories, and I like to exaggerate. Right? Not to be malicious. All right? It's just a little bit more fun. All right? Now, as most of you will know, I have three daughters. Our youngest one, Tutu, will now look at me, and she'll get this look on her face, and she'll go, "Is that true? Is this a true story?" Right? Or I'll start off, I'll get like three words in, and she'll, "Okay, I know this is not a true story." Right? And she'll look at her sisters, and she'll look to them, "Is this true?" Right? And there are times in when I will be telling a story and there will be zero exaggeration, even though you would think there's exaggeration. There's zero exaggeration at all. And I have to tell, no, this is a true story. This is really true. I'm not adding anything to this. In fact, I'm detracting from this story. Right? She's five. But she's aware enough to know, Daddy gets a little bit loose with his stories sometimes. All right? Christian, let's not be loose with our stories about God. Let's not be loose in our stories about Jesus. We don't need to exaggerate. We better not detract. We are to go out into the world and share the good news of Jesus Christ and make disciples. We better tell the truth. Right? Friends, we are loved by the best, best Father. Rest in Him. Pray with me. Father, we need you for this because we cannot do it on our own. And it is an overwhelming letter, this letter from James, this section. I am aware that my desires and belief systems and so forth can lead me to some conclusions from this text and from some others. Father, shatter the ones that have nothing to do with you and enlighten me and us to the truth of your word and to the truth of your purpose. Thank you for this time, Father. I hope and I pray that this message was from you. Bring clarity. Bring clarity for us if it wasn't. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand, put on your mask, and we'll close with a song.
the book of Jude, verses 24 and 25. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning. Go in peace.